Hi, everyone. Happy Pride and welcome to Night School. I'm Lynn and I'm part of the nightlife team at Cal Academy in San Francisco, which is where I am right now. Nightlife is our weekly Thursday night events where we mix science with cocktails, live music, and more. We are officially back in the building on select Thursdays, so come by if you get a chance. Night School is our virtual version where we send a little nightlife back home to all of you. So for our regulars, you might notice that this is not Christina. Christina is on a little break for now, but I'm really excited to introduce my co-host, Arya Natarajan. Arya, do you want to tell us a little bit about what the theme is for tonight?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Lynn. I'm super stoked to be here. And like Lynn said, I'm filling in for Christina. And today we're going to get into some things related to the new exhibit opening at the Academy, which is called New Science. And it's featuring a bunch of amazing queer scientists in a bunch of different disciplines. And we have some here with us today. But first, I want to introduce Dr. Lauren Esposito, who's going to tell us a little bit more about the New Science exhibit. And Lauren is the Academy's curator of Arachnology and also the founder of the 500 Queer Scientists campaign, which you should definitely go look up. It's incredible. And they're going to talk a little bit about the New Science exhibit. So, I'll pass it on to Lauren.
Arya, do you want to introduce the rest of the lineup for tonight first?
Rest of the lineup. Yep. Okay, cool. sorry, y'all. I'm a little nervous. First time, you know, today's the day. But
you're doing
great.
The
rest of the lineup. we're going to hear from Dr. Alegrin Fernandez, who's a microbiologist and cartoon artist, about some lessons from microorganisms about diversity and the value of diversity as a strength. And we're also going to hear from Dr. Tiara Moore, whose current roles include being a postdoc at the Nature Conservancy and being the founder and CEO of Black and Marine Science and president of a WOC Women of Color space. We're going to hear from her about making the change to find love and become a true advocate for herself. And finally, we're going to hear from Elizabeth Ruiz, who's a fish biologist at the California Sea Grant Russian River Salmon and Steelhead Monitoring Program, about endangered species and representation in STEM. Now we will say hello to Lauren, and you're going to hear from these other amazing guests a little bit later on.
Yes, and just in case you are wondering, the order is actually going to be Lauren, Tiara, Elizabeth, and then Ale. So just FYI. And now we'll bring up Lauren. Hi, Lauren.
Hey, happy Pride.
Happy Pride. Okay, me and Arya will hop off and we'll give you the stage.
Hey, everyone. Happy Pride. I am coming to you live from, camping. Because what is queerer than nature? But what I'm here to talk to you about today is an exhibit that I'm so excited about called New Science. It opened today on the public floor of the California Academy of Sciences. It's about how queer and intersectional identities are revolutionizing how science gets done. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about why we need this exhibit and what I'm hoping this exhibit will accomplish in the world of science and beyond. So why do we care about people's gender and sexual identities in science? Well, that's because heteronormative assumptions frequently silence conversations about gender and sexuality in STEM workplaces. And for those of you out there that aren't familiar with the term STEM, that stands for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And usually we throw another M on there to represent medicine. And there's a good reason why we should care about people's identities in STEM workplaces. For one, based on statistics about the number of LGBTQ people in the general population and the rate at which they're leaving STEM fields, it's currently estimated that there's as many as 121,000 LGBTQ people missing from the STEM workplace. And surveys done just over the last couple of years have found that people with LGBTQ identities that are STEM professionals are 30% more likely to have experienced symptoms of depression within the past year. And what that means is that they have greater intentions of leaving their career in the next 5 years as compared to their heterosexual and cisgendered colleagues. And that's really a tragedy for science itself, because the greater perspectives that we have means that there's more people asking questions in different ways and interpreting data with a different lens. And so people's identities matter, and they matter quite a lot. But New Science is this exhibit. It's funded by an if-then gender equity grant called a Moonshot Award. And the Moonshot Award is really an award to help increase the visual representation of women and gender minorities in STEM across museums, but it's to produce content that can be shared with other museums. And this exhibit will be freely available to any other museum, public space, or community center anywhere in the world. So what is New Science? First, it's an exhibit launching on the Academy's public floor. If you're there at Nightlife tonight, you got to see it first, but if you're not there tonight, don't worry, because you can see it on the Academy's public floor every single day for the next few months. We also have a New Science website, which features the profiles of 23 incredible people with first-person narratives, short one-minute videos of them telling their story in their own words and why their identity has mattered for their science. And lastly, we have this beautiful, immersive Google Arts and Culture digital exhibit that you can explore from your house right now today. Again, there's these, what we're featuring is these stories, and the stories are of 23 queer women and gender minorities. And by gender minorities, what I mean is trans people, gender nonconforming people, non-binary people, two-spirit people, people who have tended to be underrepresented in science because of their identity. And we're also centering people of color in this exhibit because we know that intersectional identities are important, and we want to celebrate intersectional identities, and particularly those identities of people working in STEM. I want to just share with you one quote, and this is where the name of the exhibit New Science comes from Jessica Ware, who's a dear friend and colleague. She's an entomologist studying insects at the American Museum of Natural History in New York. And one of the things that she said in her first-person story was this: gatekeeping and questions about who belongs, that's old science. New science is everybody participating, everybody supported and celebrated, and that's the type of science I want to be a part of. And I couldn't agree more with Dr. Ware. This is the kind of science I want to be a part of, the kind of science that progresses society forward in new and exciting ways, solving the challenges of the 21st century, because we need diverse perspectives and diverse voices if we're ever going to have a chance at solving these problems. We produced this exhibit in under 6 months with an incredible team right here at the Academy, including our digital engagement team, our exhibits team, our creative studios who does our design work, our communication team, our marketing team who built the website, and with a special partner, the Critical Ecology Lab, who provided consultancy on this project to ensure that we were representing intersectional identities in the way that we really wanted to. And I want to give you just a sneak peek of what this looks like in the flesh, in real life. This is the exhibit out on our public floor. It features 11 of the 23 stories. And we're really excited about these. And in particular, because the California Academy of Sciences is a museum that focuses to a large extent on the natural sciences, a lot of these folks are either based right here in the Bay Area, working in tech, working in medicine, or they're affiliated with natural science research, like the kind of research our biodiversity scientists do at the Academy. And with that, I'm really excited about the people that you're going to hear from today. These are people featured in this exhibit. These are people who either self-nominated or were nominated themselves to show up in this exhibit because people were excited about their stories. They felt that their stories needed to be told and that their voice needed to be represented out there in the world about what science is and who should be doing science. And so I'm going to hand it back over to our Nightlife team to hear more from the New Science in Night School.
Thanks, Lauren. We have a couple of questions if you have a few minutes. I saw the actual exhibit live, so I just want to say if you get the chance, please come and check it out. Aria will also drop the link to the Google Arts and Culture page in the chat in the next few minutes, so check those out. Lauren, a couple questions. So can you tell us more, a little bit more about the digital exhibit, or how can people bring it to, say, their local museums?
Yeah, so the exhibit's going to be available through a portal from Aztec, which is the Association of Science and Technology Centers. The Aztec is dropping this portal to share this kind of exhibit content, both from the New Science exhibit, but as well as other Moonshot recipients that are sharing the exhibits that they've developed, centering in particular women and gender minorities who are working in STEM. And you'll be able to access that through the Aztec portal coming up soon. But in the meantime, if you are interested in hosting this exhibit at your own institution, you can do that for low cost. We aim to make this as inexpensive as possible to produce right on your own public floor, because we think these stories need to be told all over the world. But if you want to experience the exhibit in the comfort of your own home, if you're out there wanting to read more about these people, hear their voices, read their stories, see photos of them at work, you can check that out through the Google Arts and Culture digital exhibit, which is going to be a part of the Google Arts and Culture Pride page launching tomorrow in celebration of Pride. And I think that chat's going to be shared right there that link is going to be shared right there in the chat. I can see it. So please check it out. Hear these people's stories. They're amazing.
Yeah. I have another question. Of course, there's so many stories to be told and we're only featuring 25. Is there any plans in the future to feature more? Is there a way other people can submit to be featured?
Actually, there is. We have the 500 Queer Scientists website, which, in spite of having the name 500 Queer Scientists, has over 1,500 contributions of scientists working in every discipline all over the world, undergraduates all the way up to directors of major research institutes. And you can check that out and contribute your own story, read all 1,500 stories. We're growing every single day.
Great. And Aria dropped. Yeah. It is. And Aria dropped the link, so if you want to learn more, feel free to click that. And then Aria, I'm going to let you do this last question.
Yeah, absolutely. So Lauren, you're one of the features in the story, in the exhibit. So just any parting words of advice for budding queer scientists out there who may be tuning in right now?
Yeah, so, you know, for most of my career, I felt alone. I didn't know any other queer scientists. I never had any queer mentors or role models. And what I want to say to you out there is that we're out here. We are a big, vibrant community who's progressing science forward every single day. And we are here. We are queer. And we are science.
Great. Thanks so much, Lauren. Thanks for joining. And I hope everyone gets a chance to check out all that information. Lauren, it was great to have you on.
Happy Pride!
Thanks. Thanks, Lauren.
Okay,
and next up, yeah. We're gonna kick
so
off
we're
the
just
talks.
Gonna do we're gonna do our normal housekeeping. So as always, tonight's program is live, so say hi, let us know where you're watching from. Hi to anyone watching in the building at Science Today or in the Hive Lounge on the living roof. Let us know if it's your first time joining or if you're a Night School regular. We'll have Q&As after everyone's talk, so make sure to get your questions in the chat. And with that, we will turn it over to Tierra. Once I can figure out these buttons.
All righty, I think I am good to go. Thank you so much for the feature, for allowing me to be here today. I'm Dr. Tierra Moore, and I use she, her pronouns. And today I'm gonna be talking about finding me, talking about my journey and embracing that journey in STEM. And so I'm a bit nervous as well, because this is actually the first time I've talked about this publicly at a talk setting. So thanks so much for being here and bear with me. I do want to start by acknowledging the Uchi and Cherokee East people on whose land that I reside. I'm so grateful for their stewardship to allow me to have a home. Of course, I have to say Happy Pride Month. That's why we're all here. And because of my marine science background, happy ocean month. And so in my career and what I do in STEM is that I'm really trying to understand human impacts on the environment And we have a large, you know, increase in population. There's a lot more resources that are being utilized. And so I try to understand how those impacts, how those affect the environment, specifically in relation to climate change. And so what I do specifically is I go out into estuaries and try to understand, again, how nutrient pollution can impact changes in these ecosystems. So what you're looking at, you see me sitting in the middle of a mud in the estuary, in the middle of an algal bloom. So that green that's all around it is actually algae. And so this has come in because of nutrient pollution, and it's taken over this estuary. And so as you can imagine, it would impact the species there and affect the biodiversity. And so in my job, to try to understand species biodiversity, I use a technique or a tool known as environmental DNA or eDNA. And I really love this tool because it allows me to be a forensic detective. So if you think about any crime show that you've watched, you know that you'll see a criminal do something and they'll leave a fingerprint, and then the detectives come in and sweep it up, and then they say, oh, we know who that is. And that's because as we're moving around, we're dropping genetic information, and all organisms are doing that. So you see the fish is swimming in the water, but as it moves through the water, it's leaving behind that DNA. So I, as a scientist, can go in, scoop up some of that water and tell you the biodiversity of the ecosystem or that fish that's there. So that's just a brief synopsis of what I do in my career and I guess my part in STEM. But we know we're not really here to discuss that today. It's really about my journey and how my identities really impacted me. And so in STEM, I'm what they would call a triple minority. So I'm Black, I am a woman, and I am also queer. And so now I really just want to take you on a little journey of me being able to even say this out loud, to be able to talk and openly say who I am as a person and as a scientist. So where do all stories start? with a tub picture? I'm originally from Greenwood, South Carolina. If you're wondering where my accent is from, that is it. And so this is definitely the Bible Belt South. I was definitely in the church a lot, and I was raised by my grandmother because my mom was incarcerated. So my grandmother was an evangelist. She definitely believed in going to every church service that there was. I was in the choir and going to Sunday school. But once my mom actually came home, she let us know that she now identified as a lesbian, and she was planning on getting married. And this caused a huge problem for my grandma. She's like, she's praying, she's doing all of this. We're like, oh no, what's going to happen? So for me, when I think about my sexual identity at that time during my younger days, I wanted to make this a bit fun. I think of the lyrics of a song. And so this lyrics came from the song Hate It or Love It with the Game and 50 Cent. Growing up, I was confused, my mama kissing a girl. Because for me, I didn't really have any relationships. I would read books and get lost in fantasies. But I knew that what I had been taught in the church, that was wrong. And so now here was my mom, this lady who I didn't really know like that, but coming into my life, having this whole different world. So that was how I would explain my identity in my younger days. And so because of all of that was going on, I knew that I wanted to leave the house. I know that I wanted to go to college to have a different type of trajectory. So after high school, I moved up to Rock Hill, South Carolina. I went to Winthrop University. I thought I was going to be pre-med. I thought I wanted to be a pediatrician. I realized a bit that I didn't really like kids like that, so it wasn't going to work. So I started taking other classes, and I found a tropical ecology class. And I only signed up for it because they were going to Costa Rica for spring break. So I was like, ooh, free trip. But then I got there, and we were on a boat and collecting water samples and doing these experiments. And I was like, wow, is this a real job? Like, can I get paid for this? And the answer was yes. And so I really decided to make that my career. So I applied to grad school, and I ended up going to Hampton University, which is a historically Black college and university. And that's where I became a marine scientist and did work in the Chesapeake Bay. After that, I continued my education across the country in California at UCLA and got my PhD in ecology and evolutionary biology. And so during this time in my career, I would describe my sexual identity as the song No Type by Ray Schmert. I don't got no type. And so when I look at that past, there was definitely only dating men, but they were just random. No race, no size, nothing. Just whoever I connected to, who I felt connected to, that's who I was with at that time. And so I started to think about that and say, huh, what is this? But as I started to question my sexual identity, I was growing in my career. And so I noticed that in marine science and the leadership positions that I was in, I was the literally only Black person in the room. And so there was experiences that I would have when I introduced myself as a marine scientist, people would say, oh, you can swim. Or when I would go on scientific scuba diving trips, people would ask me if I was there to carry the tanks or the equipment, never expecting me to be a part of the team. So I was there, hyper-visible, just trying to survive in this field. So my identity, I couldn't even think about that. The double minority of Black woman was enough. So I continued to suppress who I was. So then after that, I graduated. I was, got through that rut race, didn't know like, oh, maybe I'm being treated this way because I'm a student. Then I went on and I'm now at a postdoc and, Dr. Moore have earned my seat at the table. And I realized that I was having a lot of the same treatment. People were closing the lab door in my face, people asking me if I could go get them coffee, asking me things, and they're just gaslighting my experiences. And I was like, wow, how disappointing. I've worked so hard and I still don't belong. And so I decided, okay, what am I going to do? Am I going to walk away from what I've worked so hard for? Or am I going to figure out how to make this work? And so I founded the organization Awoke Space. And this is to purely create safe spaces for women of color to exist. We have virtual spaces where we have these events where we just come together and talk and say, hey, we don't see another brown person literally all day in our workspaces, but now we have this community to come together. We also have a blog where we talk about the experiences of women of color in STEM. Of course, we have merch because we want to get the message out that women of color need to take up space in their organizations. And then we've also started to do ally and DEI training where we utilize our experiences of women, as women of color, to talk about how things could be better in the workplace for us. So if you're interested in hearing more information about Awoke Space, please, 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 please follow us on any of these items. And so as I developed this organization, I started to feel more comfortable. And then also I had moved and I was now in Seattle. And I thought, Seattle seems like a safe space. And I was at a field where I could try to explore my identity. And so if I had to put a song to my identity at this point in my career, it would be Katy Perry, I Kissed the Girl, and I Liked It. And so at this point, I finally found move forward to saying, hey, this is something, this is an aspect of my life, this is how I identify. But I wasn't open. So I was in a relationship, but it was just my relationship. I probably put the rainbow flag on my Twitter bio, but I didn't discuss it or anything like that. And then 2020 happened and racism came out of the woodwork, and there was so many things going on that a lot of STEM fields created these weeks to highlight Black people and anti-Black racism and different experiences that we have in our field. And so I was able to found Black and Marine Science Week. And Black and Marine Science Week was a whole week aimed to talk about our experiences, our research as Black marine scientists, the different things that we have experienced in, and then also to inspire the next generation of youth. And then we also came together and said, hey, we want this to be really inclusive, and we want to have a day where we highlight and honor queer scientists. And I remember sitting in the meeting with my heart beating fast, here I am planning a whole day and no one really knows who I am as a person. And so I knew that during Black and Marine Science Week, I was going to have to make the step to truly say, hey, here is who I am. And so during that week, we had a session where we said, hey, if you identify in the queer community, please introduce yourself. So I was able to basically, I guess, Twitter come out on that day and say, hey, we have this week of inclusion and I don't want to be a fraud. Like, I am saying this space should be safe. And so it should be safe enough for me. And that was such a freeing day because it didn't even matter about who knew or what people said. It was about I finally had found comfort in my own identity, that it didn't matter with my followers, anybody had to say, it mattered to me that I needed to say it. And I was so, so proud of myself to be able to do that and to say, you know what? There's been a lot of stuff going on in STEM. I've been had a lot of experiences, but I am me and I belong in this space. So now Black and Marine Science has formed a whole nonprofit and is aimed to highlight Black Marine scientists, but also just change the face of who people see as scientists. So definitely check out our YouTube channel. We have a whole BIMS TV series where we have these 5-minute episodes of just different marine science topics. So please, please subscribe. And so if I had to put a lyric to the My Identity Now, it would just be a remix. And I actually tweeted this one day to the song I said earlier. Growing up, I was confused, my mama kissing the girl. Now I'm not. And so when I think about my identity and STEM and what that looks like, you know, I think about my research and trying to understand biodiversity, trying to track rare species, me literally in the mud, trying to make everything has representation. And before I even, you know, publicly came out or even I embraced my own identity, I knew that I had to make spaces for me to exist. And so now that I have added another minority to my list, it has become so much easier for me to shout at the rooftops and be an advocate for everyone. So we have true inclusion because climate change is real, science is real, COVID is real, virus, these things are real. And so the huge problem is that we have scientific issues that aren't being addressed purely because of racism, sexism, homophobia. Why? Why? And that is my goal, to just make spaces for people to exist who look like me and who don't look like me, who identify with me. So if that's you, I would say my tips are to find the space that you need to succeed. There is a lot of spaces. We can get stuck up saying, oh, we have to go to this prestigious university. I've been to all these prestigious places and they're actually not the most welcoming. So you can find a place where you're going to belong and feel safe and do just as good work there. Ask for help. That can be the hardest thing, especially as minoritized people, people who are not used to people caring about them. But we have to ask for help. People are getting paid a lot of money to be in these positions, and they're not helping us. But I have to challenge is, how much are we asking? Network everywhere you go. Always be talking about the things that you're passionate about. Always be asking people for advice or what they're going on. Now I hope I'm networking now. I hope I have people who go and subscribe to Black and Marine Science and follow my work. But most importantly, I beg you please to never, ever, 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 ever give up. If this is something that you want to do, if being a scientist, if being anything is what you want to do, don't allow your identity and how people perceive your identity to stop you. And I know I'm speaking from a place of privilege now because I literally waited till I got my whole PhD to come up. But I truly believe that this space, that the room that is now available for us, that we can have safety in these spaces. And we have a large community, as Lauren mentioned from the beginning. It's 500 queer scientists. This is really 1,500. And I don't even know if I've done a profile just because I was scared up until now. So here's one more added to the list. So please don't give up. There's a space for you. Thank y'all so much for listening. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. You have any other ways on the screen. And I guess I'll take any questions. I think I'm right on time.
Hello. Thanks so much, Tierra. This was amazing. Thank you so much for sharing your story. And anybody who's watching, feel free to drop your questions in the chat and we can ask. But one question that I did have while listening to you talk is, you have a lot going on. Like, you run so many different things and you deal with so much on a day-to-day basis. Like, how, I guess, especially in this past year where things have been, you know, a kind of a whole new level of chaotic, for lack of a better word, how do you manage to find balance and rest and manage all of it? And
That's such a great question. And I think I get it often because it does sound like a lot, but I think there is an aspect of the work that I do that is purely for my own survival. And so I think when I look at it like that, there is a point where either I was going to walk away from STEM and walk away from the career that I literally spent years trying to get, or I was going to find ways for me to be able to thrive and succeed. And so I think while it is a lot of work, the work that I probably, you know, maybe I shouldn't say this out loud, but I can spend a lot more time, you know, focusing on that work because there's so much joy and I find so much more fulfillment. So I do that. So I am able to have the space and the capacity to do my science work, because there was times when I couldn't, just because of experiences of racism where I didn't want to, you know, publish papers with the co-authors I worked with, but just because of the treatment that I had, you know. And so now I'm getting to a place where it's like, okay, I can work on it. I can figure this out because I now have that community that I need. So I think there is balance. But I mean, also, I'll be real, you know, I take time for myself. I get my nails done, get my hair done. You know, deep breathing.
Good. I love them.
It's not as much as it can seem to other folks, just because of the joy that it brings me.
Yeah. Yeah. And along these lines, so in working on all of these like community building initiatives, what are the future plans? What have you got lined up in the next few months, few years?
Well, we are going to be, so I told you Black and Marine Science is a full nonprofit. We will be having BIMS week too. So we had BIMS week last year. We're going to be having a whole nother week of events in November. Let me just tell y'all, we did drop the save the date. But November 28th through December 4th. So definitely check out Black and Marine Science. And I think the whole goal is to really just take over marine science, to really make it as, to build inclusivity in marine science, to really say, hey, the ocean, the earth is 71% water. Like, why aren't more people excited about it? And I think it can be sold as this stuffy kind of little place. And it's like, why? There's people like me who do marine science. We should have more fun people here. So I think we're really, again, just trying to change how it's even communicated, how it's talked about, because we have so much fun, like scuba diving and traveling to all these different places. And so that's the breakthrough that I would like to see, in having more Black and brown, queer, scientists in the field is definitely the new wave.
yeah. Oh, I love that. And kind of a related question, but what's the best scuba spot in your experience through all your dives?
Oh man. So I think just because this was a specific activity, but there I was diving. I did a research trip in Bali, Indonesia. And as one of the activities, so we would be diving, like scientific diving, three times a day, super hard work, like down there doing a lot. But on the weekends, or, you know, if we had free time, we could do like some fun excursions. And so we actually went and did a shipwreck dive, and it was pretty deep, but it was a whole just huge ship that had been taken over. It was basically now a coral reef. And it was just so amazing to see. There was organ, there was fish there. It was all types of organisms that had just reutilized this sunken ship. So that was just an amazing experience as far as the dive.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That's incredible. Thank you so much for answering all these questions and for sharing your story once again. It was amazing to hear from you. Everybody who's watching, Tiara's website is linked in the chat, so you can go look her up, go ask her questions, and I will pass it on to our next speaker, who is I believe Ale, and yeah, my Tiara. It's not Ale, it's Elizabeth. Yes. Yeah, Elizabeth is our next speaker. Sorry, my notes are all out of order, but yeah.
Oh my goodness, hello. Happy Pride, everybody. I am so thrilled to be here. I can't believe I got to hear Dr. Moore's amazing story. It's just such a thrill. So yes, my name is Elizabeth Ruiz. I'm a fisheries biologist on the Russian River, which is here in California. It's only like an hour north of San Francisco and Cal Academy. And I'm here to talk to you about what it's like to be a marginalized person in STEM and work with an endangered species. So I'd like to introduce you to the watershed first. And of course I have to acknowledge that the Russian River watershed is the Aboriginal homelands of the Southern Pomo, Coast Miwok, and Kashaya Pomo peoples, as well as other Pomo communities. And I am streaming to you from Southern Pomo lands. And big thank you to the Grayton Rancheria for educating me about this. And I really hope to continue learning from these communities. And the Russian River starts in the coastal range up by Willits. It flows about 110 miles until it reaches the ocean at Jenner. It spans Mendocino and Sonoma counties, and it drains an area of about 1,500 square miles. It's home to more than 360,000 residents and provides drinking water to almost double the number of people. It's also a NOAA habitat focus area, which basically means that the federal government has these very clear goals for what they would like to see from this river in terms of functionality in this basin. So some of those things are getting fish populations to sustainable levels, better weather predictions, and then also improved resiliency of communities and ecosystems to climate change. And in addition to all of the people who live in this amazing watershed, I'll be talking about the salmonids of the Russian River. And there's three main species here. They all belong to family Salmonidae, which is a family of rayfin fishes. And that includes salmon and trout and white fishes and chars. And what's really unique about these fish that we have here is they're all anadromous, which means they spend a part of their life in fresh water. They make this amazing migration to the ocean. They spend a portion of their life there, and then they return to where they were born in freshwater streams to spawn. And depending on the species, those life histories look a little bit different, but they all have this in common, this transition between freshwater and saltwater. What's a huge bummer about working with these amazing fish is they're all threatened or endangered, and they're all in dire straits. So Chinook salmon, they've been listed as threatened since 1999, so 22 years ago. Steelhead trout have been threatened since 2006, and coho salmon, they were listed as threatened in 1996, so 25 years ago, and they were listed as endangered under the Endangered Species Act in 2012. So less than 10 years ago, coho salmon were listed as endangered, which is really a shame because these fish represent so much. They have a lot of different names. They have a lot of different histories. And I think this is where I really start to see myself in the fish because, you know, names hold your story and your power, and you know, they're a part of you. And depending on your history, like your life, your name may be different than what you started with, or it may be different depending on who you're talking to. So we can uncover some of the rich history of these fish through their names. So the genus name is Oncorhynchus. It comes from Greek and it means hooked nose. And it refers to a kype that the male coho get when they're sexually mature. The common name comes from a Hokomelon word, which is in the Salish language family, and it comes from the word kohos. And I was able to connect with someone who speaks a different Salish language, and in Colville Okanagan Salish, the word is kisu, which sounds extremely similar to kisuch, which is the Russian name for coho and also the species name. And many people who fish also know these awesome animals as silver salmon. So again, there's this fish plays so many different roles in the ecosystem. It's a keystone species. It's, you know, they were once very, very abundant and a really important food source for people and animals, and they bring back critical nutrients from the sea. So there's a lot of history here, and it's really important. And it may just be one fish, but it's many, many stories. And they go through these really distinct life stages, and they transform and they grow. And when they're laid as eggs, those eggs are the size of a pea. And when they return as adults, they could be as long as a French baguette. You know, like, they undergo these magnificent changes, and it's natural and it's beautiful, and it matches up with the seasons. And they're so connected to place, and they're so connected to the world around them. Like, the fish here are different than the fish up in Alaska. Like, this is the Central California Coast Evolutionary Significant Unit. These are it's a special type of fish. And you can see, like, as they go through their life cycle, they change shape, they change color, they, you know, they get shiny, they get colorful, they turn red when they come back. They're really, really magnificent. And in this way, I feel connected to the fish because I too have undergone changes with understanding my gender and my sexuality and my place as a Latina scientist. And, you know, moving from place to place, my role has been different, just like from place to place, like the role of this fish has been different. And some more, you know, I see a lot of similarities between myself as a marginalized person and these fish because they are up against so many obstacles. Coho really have just gotten the short end of the stick. And on the left, you can see a picture of a stream that in the winter flows and fish flock to it. You know, like, this is where successful spawning occurs. And in the summer, it's completely dry. And on the right, what was once a really dense structure, a really important part of the habitat, the in-stream habitat, was burned by the Wallbridge fire last year. So habitat loss, habitat degradation, climate change, intensity of storms, like, these fish are barely hanging on. And at times it really feels like when you're talking about a queer identity or your identity as a person of color in science, like, I also have felt like I was barely hanging on to science and to research. And like, these fish is what got me through, basically, because when you work with an endangered species, there's one very clear and very obvious goal, and that is to keep them from going extinct. It is so basic, it is so simple, and it's very much tied to our own survival. If we can get this fish to survive, if we can keep this fish in this river, maybe we too can be successful in this watershed. And so the coho were kept from being extirpated from the Russian River watershed by a hatchery broodstock program. And as you can see, they were basically gone in the early 2000s. And it's taken years for those fish to actually start returning. And this is one part of it. This is addressing one problem. So where I come in is I can help plant those fish. I can help count the returning adults and measure them and, you know, track them and interact with them on a personal level when they're out migrating. And when you're wearing waders and when you're in the stream with the fish, with the science, I feel such a sense of belonging. And that is not something, like, as a queer Latina person, that has been really common in my life. It just, when people see me when I'm wearing my waders, and especially if it's in a stream that, you know, we have a really good presence in, people don't question why I'm there. And they don't question whether or not I know my stuff because I'm doing it right there in front of them. There's not much folks can say to that. So it's very empowering. It's very much a way to say, I belong here. I belong in these streams, just like these fish. Like, I'm a part of this system and I'm here. And, you know, it might be a funny concept to talk about building solidarity with your environment, but a connection to place is really so healing, especially when you're the only person that's like you at your office or at your lab. Connecting with the rivers and the streams and the fish and the wildlife can really help guide your healing process. And it helps me personally stay focused on what is important. So even when it gets really challenging, like at the end of the day, like I still need to keep these fish in this river. And to do that, I need to keep the river flowing and I need to make sure that, you know, all the plants have a chance to shade the river and I'm a part of it. And finally, like what's really, really beautiful about building solidarity and community is these incredible people like Dr. Moore are putting together these incredible online communities where Black and Indigenous voices and other people of color can speak their truth and do their science without sacrificing their identity. And that has just been such a revelation for me. And the level of support that I've received from other queer and gender diverse individuals, and also like learning from the disabled community and folks who are also neurodivergent, it's just, it makes me feel so much less alone. And it makes me feel like loved and protected and supported. Like I might be the only person here at this office, but like my community has my back and they got me. And just like with people, we know what the fish need. They need water. They need cold water that's cool. They need structure. They need shelter. You can see these small fish, these small coho, swimming amongst the roots and the leaves. And, you know, this is a very delicate system. They need a landscape that's managed effectively, just like we do. And where would we be without water? It's just, it connects everything together. And just like the fish, like queer people and people of color, like we need to be known and we need to be understood and we need to be heard. And so when I think about advocating for these fish, I'm always advocating for myself and for communities like me and communities outside of my identities who will also benefit from the protection of sensitive species. And it's like a big old bummer, like all of the terrible things, climate change, the fires, it's hard at times, but there is some hope. I mean, the fish are still here. We're still here out there counting them. They're still spawning. You can see this female coho digging at her nest to lay her eggs. You can see on the left that there is a burned redwood still standing tall. And there's a future. Like we have a future and there is positive change happening around us despite all of the obstacles and the roadblocks. We can stock fish. I have been a part of projects where, you know, we've managed to add water to the creek and work with partners to get the stream literally flowing again during the historic drought. And this all happens on a personal level. And so what I want to leave you with is just imagine our rivers and our systems thriving, and imagine the fish thriving, and imagine all of the work that our queer ancestors and our ancestors of color have put into making this world a better place for us. And then just don't settle for anything else. Don't settle for less. So if you want to learn more about our work, I have some sources here, and you can find both my program, which is California Sea Grant, and the Russian River Salmon and Steelhead Monitoring Program on social media.
Hi, Elizabeth.
Hi.
We have time for some questions. Sorry, I'm trying to do multiple things at once. I love that kind of analogy that you found within kind of the work that you do. How did you get into salmonids? Did you kind of always see these similarities before you even started the work? Is that like what drew you to them, or did you just kind of start to notice as you were working?
So I kind of became a fisheries biologist just from the support of my community. I was invited into scientific spaces as an undergraduate by other people of color and queer scientists. And my initial work was just with water. And I learned that water can tell a story and it has a history. And depending, you know, where you go, like the challenges that water faces are different, but there are still challenges. And as I was learning these lessons, water brought me to the salmon and steelhead of coastal California. And as soon as I saw that first coho salmon, I just decided this was it, and I was never going to do anything else. Like, this was my purpose.
That's great. I'm trying to figure out what's the best question next. Okay, like your waders, are there any other ways that you find and build your own habitats or spaces to thrive in your everyday work and field?
Yes. So whenever I have the chance to work with someone who gets it, like another person of color or a queer person, you know, we do these surveys together, and it's such a privilege to be able to see this beautiful landscape and hike together with these streams and these fish. And, you know, we go for miles and we end up just the two of us with nature. And it's amazing to connect with others who have had similar experiences. And so, you know, I wouldn't still be in science had it not been for other people who validated me and supported me. And, you know, part of the reason why I want to stay in science is so that I can pay that forward to other marginalized scientists and people.
Yeah, kind of speaking about paying it forward, or just generally, what are you thinking about as far as future plans? Like, what are you, do you have any upcoming projects?
So I just started leading a project on a really important tributary of the Russian River called Marquess Creek. And we're looking at the current stream flow and water quality conditions and kind of the wetted habitat availability during the dry months, to see where we can do stream flow improvement projects and where they could be successful, and also monitoring like before and after implementation. And so what's special about this particular project is many of the stream flow enhancement projects, such as rain catchment and getting folks off of wells, this is happening after the Tubbs fire. And so many, many people in that watershed unfortunately lost their homes, and they are using it as an opportunity. As they rebuild, they're taking the opportunity with the help of partners to make their new home more stream friendly. And so that is really inspiring to me. And that's something that I'll be working on this year and next year.
Cool. Maybe we can bring you back on after you've done those projects. I think we have time for just a few. There's some quick questions. Did Russian immigrants, speaking kind of the naming of the salmon, did Russian immigrants in that part of California adopt the Salish word?
You know, I actually don't know. This is information that I learned while I was putting this talk together. And I would love to learn more about the connection between those words, like where it came from and who gave it to who. But the fact that the words are so similar and just the geographic distance that word had to travel is really awesome. I think, you know, looking into the indigenous words for the plants and animal species that we have in these watersheds is really important, because that is such a part of connecting to place and people.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Elizabeth, for joining us tonight. It was such a pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Happy Pride, everybody.
Thanks. Up next, we have L.A. Garin Fernandez.
So, hey, everybody. I hope you can hear me. Thanks for the invitation. I'm super happy to be here. The talks before, they were really touching. I really love them. And thanks to the opportunity to share part of my story and my journey and some lessons I got from the microbial world, that is the biodiversity group that I'm more amazed by and in love about all microbes. So I'm in the social networks as Microbiale. I'm doing currently science communication, where I'm highlighting the diversity of the microbial world and the people who study them in a bilingual context. But yeah, who I am. Since my childhood, I have been always in a kind of always in the middle of everything. Although I studied science, I was always doing in free time, arts and comic projects, or in the theater while I was working at the lab in biotechnology in my undergrad. So for my scientific friends, I was always the artistic person and vice versa. And although I'm Chilean, we are living in an extreme area, so in the northern Chile, where, as my mom say, you are too Peruvian to be Chilean and too Chilean to be Peruvian. And I'm coming from an indigenous community there from South America that is called Aymaras. But I was living in a city, so how much Chilean I am, how much Aymara am I? Or I'm just people of color, like, yes, it's not enough. And right now I'm starting, or I start already my journey to accept and my gender identity as a non-binary person. And it had been a hard path to understand myself and to also accept myself as I am. So, long story short, I don't fit in my surrounding, and it had never been that. And I had been with the weirdo and the outsider. And although that is not always bad, sometimes it's hurting. But it was fine. I was the weirdo. I was la rara. So, but that feeling got stronger as a migrant. After I finished my undergrad in Chile, I got a scholarship, a DAD scholarship, to travel to Germany and do my PhD, where I was working in phage ecology, in community dynamics and diversity of viruses, and especially focused in phages, so the virus who infect bacteria, which is actually one of the most diverse and abundant, and also one of the most underrated members in the ecosystem. And there I came as the outsider. And that gave me the space to be more vulnerable with that feeling of being the weirdo. And with that, with working with viruses, I also learned about the microbial community. And that can be really diverse and rich, but that's also necessary and important. And while I was working on it, I also got some lessons of the microbial world that are helping me in that self-acceptance journey and accept myself as I am. And today I want to share with you some thoughts about it. So I'm part of this indigenous community. I'm also non-binary, that's hard to say it loud, and also pansexual. About microbes. The majority of our world is actually microscopic. And microbes has also a key role in evolution I'm the starring of life and maintenance of our planet and every living being there. And it's that community is extremely diverse. And there are so many tags, that there are so many groups, that it's even hard to have a universal concept of a species, for example. And now with more access to new technologies, now we are able to see and to research about groups that they were overlooked for most of the microbial history that we can record. So they were overlooked from this, from our register and in our microbiology books. But who are those overlooked groups? Well, here you can see little graph that I got from this paper, where you can see that they are certain species that you can identify with general or more broader techniques, where you can identify the most abundant groups. But when you have this access, for example, to metagenomics, to get the DNA of the environment, you can get some groups that they are in a really low abundance. So in other words, there is in the ecosystem, there is a small group of a few species who are highly dominant, but there is also another group that they are so diverse, they are spread in so many different concepts and contexts that they are called the rare biosphere. And in the ecosystem, they are normally less than 1% when you are even study them. But this rare biosphere, most of the time when you are investigating them, you are finding new metabolites, new metabolic processes. And that's because their history, their evolution history, are giving them those skills to make those processes. And also they are given the skill to have different contexts, because their context, their surroundings is different, and the giving those new skills are giving also new experiences, and they are enriching the discussions because they are the rare biosphere. They are not so many. And I'm not sure in which moment I stopped to talk about microbes and I start to talk about that other rare biosphere. And also, a high diverse community, when this rare biosphere is having in a higher percentage, also can persist in long term. That means when in an ecosystem there are so many different species, when it's a change of the environment, they can have different roles, and they can support each other against the change of the environment, against the hard moments. And they can support each other to go through those moments and bring new products and, in this case, metabolites. But in our case, new contexts, new histories, new stories, new point of view that are also helping to our research, for example. So a higher society, a diverse society, is stronger, not weaker. We need that rare biosphere surrounding us. But on the other side, as the rare biosphere is in a small percentage, there are also so many challenges for that. And for the rare biosphere, we need support. We need support from all the other members to make connections, to get in this community network, to resist and to support each other, to feel that we are not just a few, but although we are a few, we are really important there, and we are completely valid. So, this is still not a finished journey. I found amazing people from different contexts, part of this high richness of groups, and also part of this diversity. of those minorities, as Kiara was mentioning, and clearly really well. And that people I found in my journey as the queerspora, for example, activist, queer migrant group in Bremen, Germany, who we are all diverse, we are all different. And also coming from scientific context or not, or also a scientific science communication context or academia context. The people I met in my journey, everybody accept me as I am. And that made me feel valid and having this support to be here now, to talk with you, to talk that although it's sometimes it's hard, I'm not alone in this. But it's because I'm part of that rare biosphere. And we are finding each other, bringing those spaces, be loud, and be supported to resist. So, it's Pagarpa.
Hi, hello. Thank you so much, Ale. It was so wonderful hearing your talk and seeing your beautiful slides. Those are all your own illustrations, right? Yeah.
Yes.
So would you mind telling us a little bit more about your illustrations in general and your journey with them and where they brought you?
Yeah, I mean, I always got the possibility to draw, like, as I say, like in my free time, because, you know, in academia and research, you have so much free time that you are also using for drawing. And I got the possibility to draw some comics for a science communication event. And afterwards, everything was so organic. And I was also, by my surrounding of amazing and inspired women scientists who were giving me the possibilities to explore more about this illustration and make comics about the macrobiology context and also the people who are researching them. And yeah, now after some years, I can work as a scientific cartoonist on that. And yeah, if you follow me and check all my drawings, I have also a website, it's Microbiale, and also the network as Microbiale.
Yeah. It's so cool to see how it's such a common theme between actually all three of you, that your work is kind of like an exploration and another way to explore your identity and it works in tandem. It's amazing. And speaking of your research, microbial research sounds like it's super fast paced and always turning out new things. So I guess like out of all of your work with microbes and marine phages, what are some of the most, I guess, like fascinating or specific fascinating things that you've uncovered in your work with them?
In my PhD, I work with marine phages, I'm mostly focused in a group who were like vibrio-phages, so the viruses who are able to infect potentially pathogenic vibrio species, like vibrio cholera, what's making the cholera disease. And for example, to give it one of the things I learned from them, like for example, the virus who is the species that is the vibrio cholera that is giving the cholera disease, use of certain groups or like strains of that are able to have that, to give that disease to humans, which are able to produce the cholera toxin. And this cholera toxin was coming in the past, like in the evolutionary past, by an infection of a virus that get entered into the genome. So it's a kind of inception of infection. And that I found it so amazing, like all those lysogenic viruses, the virus which are able to enter to that genome and just staying there. And what they are doing in the evolutionary, giving new skills and so like giving new superpowers. All of that was so amazing. I love that, and I love to research that. In the North Sea, we got the possibility to go into a cruise and taking samples on that. I was never in a research cruise, so like that was amazing. Like coming from the desert, although it was a coastal area, and going to that environment that was whoa. Even one night I cried there on board. Like, it was so emotionally amazing.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, being out there, I can only imagine. I would also probably cry. yeah, that's amazing. It sounds like there's just so much evolution and change that's constantly happening, which is super fascinating. And then one last question. We had a note in the chat from Rin about being a scientist. If you have ADHD or are dealing with something in the same vein. And so my question is, like, broadly, what are your thoughts on how we as scientists can kind of be more inclusive and supportive of diversity in our day-to-day interactions with people around us, like just at the kind of like micro scale, like, if you will.
Yeah, you can always be active in the activist way in your own spaces. Like, you can do like macro changes that in a bigger context, they are making bigger ones as microbes. So if you are part of the rare biosphere, try to talk with other members of the rare biosphere. We are so few in the graph. It's like in the graph, we are hard to don't feel alone, and we are, many of us are kind of shy to be open on that. But once it's a little light on it, you can make that connection. You can start to exchange the information to make this community getting stronger. But if you're not part of that rare biosphere and you are part of those more broader, those dominant groups in those spaces, give us the voice, give us the spaces. And as you are researching about your own field, you can also research about what is happening in your own spaces, questioning that and ask about. Don't assume us. Yeah. Don't assume that, I think you know what I mean. Don't assume what we need. Ask what we need. And don't question that.
I like that. Yeah, asking questions.
And also give us spaces and give your time for other non-academical spaces. You are going to find so many amazing people that can make even your research better, because they are bringing you context and questions that you never ask about yourself, about your research.
Yeah, I love that, listening more closely to the rare biosphere. Yeah. Thank you so much once again. It's been lovely hearing from you and hearing about your stories and seeing your illustrations. And I think we're going to bring Lynn back up to close us out. But yeah, thank you again, Ali.
Hi. Well, thank you everyone for tuning in tonight, and a very special thank you to Lauren, Tiara, Elizabeth, and Ale for sharing your stories with us. Also, a thank you to Aria for joining and surviving our first night school together. It's been a good one. If you are able to, if you're in the Bay Area, please come and check out the new exhibit, New Science. It'll be here for quite a while, I believe, so please come by. Next week, we'll be talking about the color of life and how it's more than just aesthetics in the natural world. Learn about how color is created and plays a crucial role in the day-to-day life and survival of countless species, from scientists who study birds, frogs, and butterfly wings. And then some night school news. So starting next week, night school will actually be moving to monthly episodes on the first Thursday of the month. It has been such a pleasure spending almost every Thursday with all of you over the last year plus. I know Christina would say so if she was here. And as we just start to ramp up our in-person events, we're just excited to be able to continue bringing Night School to those who are not able to attend in person. We'll miss seeing you guys every week, but hope to see you every first Thursday, which reminds us that you should subscribe. Aria?
Yeah, turn those notifications on. The recordings all will stay on the YouTube channel, so you can share this one, you can share the others. And stay tuned. More will be coming. I will be back. So you'll see more of us and amazing guests.
Thanks, everyone. Have a good night.